have one more, item 12. You need to say change it on capital B. Put your hand for it.
Yeah.
Making a mess out of those things, Tim.
Y'all leave me alone.
Everybody has to.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this next item is product of just some recent discussions that I've had with some of you and some recent just occurrences with respect to some of the zoning matters that have come before the board. And here's what, to the extent that I have an objective, here's what my objective is today. My objective is to get some clarity, hopefully so that as we proceed forward, I think that I have made, at least the ones I've talked to, clear that my expectation is that, the zoning agenda is going to continue to be very active. We're going to continue to have a lot of zonings coming for the Board of Commissioners. And some of these issues just continue to surface, and my hope is that we can provide some clarity with respect to possibly any UDC modifications we may need to undertake to just, ensure that when a matter is coming to the Board of Commissioners, that the only thing that you are thinking about is the public policy behind the land use and not some of the other issues that we are becoming mired down in. So obviously the objective and the goal is clarity. Let me bring the first one to you. I have passed out to you UDC Chapter 8, and you can see I have highlighted in yellow this site plan minimum requirements. All applications shall be accompanied by 10 copies of a site plan prepared by a registered land surveyor, engineer, etc. You may recall at the last board meeting, regular meeting, Commissioner Levant and I had a discussion back and forth about what that means, what it doesn't mean, whether site plans were sufficient, whether they weren't sufficient. And I believe I indicated that the insertion of etc. into the UDC carried with it an element of discretion. If you've got a site plan has to be prepared by a land surveyor, well, you know what that means. Has to be prepared by an engineer, you know what that means. But then when you add in et cetera, that means something else. And that's where I have had to go to Mr. Brown and say, what are you comfortable with that meaning? But what it's also doing is with respect to these site plans, it is inserting an area of confusion that we are continually being asked about. And so my point is, would the board be interested in modifying this language? And kind of what Mr. Brown and I talked about was one way or the other. And what I mean by that is to say this, look, Chapter 8 is clear that the site plan that accompanies a rezoning is not an engineered plan. It says it right there in that paragraph that I've highlighted for you. So it's not an engineered plan, but on the other hand, we clearly anticipate that an engineer can prepare these documents. So can a land surveyor, right? I'm not asking of you, could we possibly choose one way or the other? Could we either say that a site plan that accompanies a zoning is going to be prepared by a land surveyor or an engineer, period? Or we take a different approach altogether and say a site plan is a concept plan and need not be prepared by such a professional at all, so long as it otherwise satisfies Mr. Brown's concerns as to sort of a conceptual plan. My thought is what we're trying to do right now is we're trying to split the baby, and it's not working from a standpoint of clarity, I think, with some members of the public. Could we choose to go either a formal route or let's go a less formal route? But right now my concern is we're going to continue to have citizens come forward and say we don't understand. So that's my request of you today, and obviously I want to hear Mr. Brown's comment as well. And I've got another point to make on another portion of this, but right now that's what I wanted to lay in front of you.
I'm not so sure they said they didn't understand. It sounded more like they had a legal conclusion of their own that it had to be an engineer or survey as of now. And you're saying it does not?
Because of the word et cetera.
Et cetera. Right. Mm-hmm. Let's hear Mr. Brown's opinion real quick.
It is my opinion that we can accept these from someone other than
a land surveyor or an engineer. It's part of my roles as your planning director to make those kind of interpretations in the code. And historically, we provided that kind of flexibility for one main reason is a small rezoning, it doesn't put that heavy cost on the applicant to come out of pocket and pay an engineer or a land surveyor to prepare a fairly technical drawing when the code itself is acknowledging that it's a conceptual product at this stage, and all that engineering comes after if they get rezoned and if they move forward with the project. So we've not historically required it. That's been a big reason why, because of the cost. And I agree exactly with what Ken said, is it seems like it's come time to take a stand and either push it one way or the other.
And I will tell you, just as an attorney, the use of the word et cetera in an ordinance is to say it's a little loose doesn't quite capture it. I mean, the reality is we probably need, candidly, to, if for no other reason than to give Mr. Brown some help, we probably need to firm that up.
But I agree, Mr. Brown, historically, as long as we've always dealt with this, the first site plans, it's been drawn up by an engineer, but it's not an official site plan to help people get through, because the final site plan seems to always change when it's submitted to you for the final site plan. Then it is a full-fledged cost-inducing product that they have to come up with. But when in the beginning, it's just kind of conceptual, as you said, to see what we can do with this property. Because nobody wants to spend $100,000 and not get zoned.
I agree.
Yeah. I mean,
You agree that it probably should just be a conceptual at that point? In case they don't get the zoning, they haven't spent all this money and then not even get the zoning?
But then are we reducing it by taking out, is the et cetera been sort of protecting us in on the one hand? I know it's been abused on the other, maybe a little, but if we, will all of a sudden people come and start bringing things that are not acceptable, you know? That
if we take away, et cetera, maybe what we also can do is this list of 17 things that follows it is allow my staff to take a look at that and make sure we have what we want in that list and put the focus on getting the information we need to make a good land use decision, not who prepared it.
Yeah. Not just get the density right, almost right before land use plan. So you want to just make one choice or the other, conceptual?
Or why can't we say for a certain size and down, it doesn't have to be from an engineer, but for a certain number of acres and up, it does?
Well, that's a good point. That is one thing we've seen over time is just this last Thursday, we had some fairly significant large projects that have been in the works for months. And there's an expectation, not built into the code, but it's an expectation from the board, I think, that they're going to see a little more detail with a project like that than if they saw a half acre going over to CBD for a flower shop. It's not the same product. The minimums are the same, but you're going to expect to go above and beyond in certain areas, and we could have that kind of a tiering system.
But we leave it up to the developer, too. I mean, if we got 17 points, you go by that you already have listed. So why not make it conceptual when we first start out? In the final stages, you can ask for a more detailed plan, but at first it's be conceptual.
So you're saying take away the registered land surveyor and engineer altogether?
Yes. Is there one point you said, Ken, Counselor?
Well, my option was to try and say I would prefer we go one or the other ways. I mean, at a minimum, I'm requesting you to take out et cetera altogether and just decide whether we're requiring land surveyors and engineers or not. Commissioner Boff's point's well taken. Perhaps we say, look, if you've got a site plan that's attempting to rezone property of more than 5 acres, it has to be done by a surveyor or engineer, period, with their professional credentials on the document. Less than 5 acres, there's no requirement at all, so long as it meets these 17 things. So literally, an unsophisticated property owner could simply come in and not have to spend money at all. Candidly, the larger property owners have no problem meeting these requirements anyway. I mean, the more sophisticated.
And most developers have people they work with all the time, and they sit down and get a really good feel for it even before they finalize an offer to buy the property. I mean, they sort of know what they're getting. Not to the point that they want to spend $100,000 like when they get into an LDP. But they are working with people that are professionals from the...
If they spend extra money on the concept plan to make it more accurate upfront, almost every time, by the time it goes through the process, there's additional conditions put on the property, which makes them redo that professional plan completely all over again. So you're actually making them spend twice or something.
I mean, they don't really go out and
survey. Is that really... I mean, if they thought they were going to submit something to us that we'd accept without having all those changes to them all the time, we always make massive changes. We always have different conditions and change the density. It just happens through the process. Very rarely does it stay the same.
Well, you know, like I said, most big developers have them. They work off the tax map, site plans. They don't even actually go out there and survey it.
At that point, they're done because there's a lot of money to pay them.
Yeah, and so they can work off, but most of them do have them. I mean, I would go, if you're going to do a land bay, at least make it above 50 acres or something better.
And whatever you do, and if you don't make them go to the full-blown engineered survey right now, certainly Tom's office can use their discretion, whether it's adequate or not. That's what they did. We give them that discretion like we do in a lot of other things.
We're going to take this for UDC change, don't we?
We will take two public hearings.
We'll have a public hearing. See what they said about it.
That's fair enough.
So with respect to, and I've got another issue for you, but with respect to direction, are you comfortable with A, removing et cetera, and then trying to divide up for one acreage one way and then over a certain threshold another way?
I
think regardless of the size, they should contain the 17 things here.
Oh, of course.
Yeah, of course.
The issue is, you know, whether it carries an engineer's stamp or not, in my mind.
Well,
for certain size properties.
Yeah, pretty much on this thing that we're looking at, right where it says site plan fared by, all the way through, et cetera, which probably ought to be blank until we have our public hearing and
we can't change
everybody's thoughts. I know, I'm just saying, but for now, just don't try to add or change or say we're going to take et cetera out or say we're going to change that.
That just throws into a long process. We start listing and start changing. I mean, we need to have some kind of product now to say you agree with this or not.
Starting point.
We need a document to advertise to say we're having a hearing.
I just don't think you need to get in a huge expense before we even give zoning. Sometimes you get denied. Most all the time it gets changed.
Well, that's I think, 30, 40, 50 acres, something like that.
I can go with that. That sounds good.
You know, 20 acres or whatever.
Right.
I mean, how many houses can you put on there?
That's why I said like 50 acres, maybe in the middle. We drop something like that, council.
We could do a divided process. I mean, the key is just clarity.
Yeah.
I mean, as more of these come in, we just need to be clear what is required so that everybody who approaches the board understands that this is either correct or it's not correct, and therefore we know, and that's not a concern.
Now, do we need to add state of Georgia approved engineer license?
Well, that was another point I was going to get to, though, is that to the extent that we have a threshold that says this profession is required to do the plans, then it's as simple as saying, and whoever does the plans needs to certify that that's their plans. To the extent we don't require that, on some of the lower threshold things, that obligation wouldn't be there. I mean, this stuff we're talking about is fairly simple to do.
Yes.
I think 40 above, 30 above. Below that, you don't have to be so clear.
Well, if you make it 50 or above, then you're really just putting most of the requirements for central and north for side, because there's not any large tracks left.
South, District 3. But they still find tracks down there. I mean, they're still bringing tracks forward.
Yeah, they are. There's still tracks that are definitely 40 and 50 acres down there, but they're bringing forward.
You comfortable with 50 acres of them? I
like 20. Also, isn't there some sort of a thing of it's around 9 acres that you have to monitor for the EPD?
Under BMPs?
Yeah, BMPs. There's a size of around 9 acres. Something kicks in besides our zoning that has to do with the And now, I don't know whether that means you need an engineer or an engineer to draw it up, but there is this thing between 8 and 10 acres.
It's after an acre where our engineering department's gonna start having some involvement from land grading standpoint.
No, there's something, unless the law changes.
Higher than an acre, if you have a grade more than an acre, you can't do all stuff.
And it follows some of that BMP policy of the state.
No, there's some of them.
What size y'all go with Cooper County, what are y'all, 30, 40, 50?
I personally like 20.
40 has a comfort zone with me for now, just a starting point.
Sandy?
I'm interested to hear.
The largest tracts are gonna be in your district.
Yeah, I mean, I'm interested to hear the pros and cons about.
Well, we'll do the starting point.
We have to start with 40. 40, right.
Sort of in the middle.
40, council. Okay.
Before we move on, and Mr. Brown and I will work and put together some language and we'll commence the, well, I'm gonna ask you for a motion to commence the process once we finish this next item. Turn your page on the handout I provided you to 89.4. This is in the context of a matter that we discussed on Thursday related to the zoning condition amendment and the public hearing. This is something I've discussed with you as well, and I wanna raise it with you again. If you see that 89.4 deals with the process for zoning condition amendments and basically says that an applicant-initiated postponement of the public hearing is authorized. It then provides criteria by which that postponement can occur, and you'll see B, capital B, 1, A, B, and C. The applicant who requests the postponement agrees to pay for the re-advertising and the posting of the signs on the property as may be determined by the director, which indicates, at least in our UDC, that it's not automatic, it's as may be determined by the director. So to the extent that Mr. Brown has a UDC to comply with, that's what is, there is discretion in that language. I'm asking with respect to moving forward that we have first of all, we have one protocol. Number one is advertised public hearings, with respect to an advertised public hearings, short of some extreme circumstance, we go forward with the public hearing as advertised. If it is postponed, if there is a request to postpone the public hearing, that the applicant, not as a matter of discretion, but as a matter of rule, is required to pay for the re-advertising and the reposting of the signage.
Even if the board requests the postponement?
If the board requests the postponement, it would be up to the board to fund that, if it's the board requests the postponement.
But if they request a postponement of their item?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
So I'm talking about a UDC modification with respect to that as well, and just as a matter of moving forward, that would be my request to you. I think that is, from my perspective, I think that is the better, safer, more conservative approach.
So have a public hearing since we've advertised one?
And not postpone it, or if we do postpone it, we postpone it with enough of a cushion where Mr. Brown can do all the things he's gonna have to do.
But if they have a question, they have to pay for it.
Everything.
If they're granted it. What do you do with the situation where we go ahead with the public hearing, delay the decision, and for whatever reason decide to have another public hearing anyway?
I think that's fine. I think if we go ahead and have the public hearing and have a second public hearing, even though we postponed, I think that's fine. Again, though, if you're gonna have another public hearing, I think that you would want to go ahead and advertise it as well, you know, given that the utility of having a second one would be limited if it's not advertised.
If we're asking for a public hearing, a second public hearing, then we should pay for it.
I mean, we usually don't do that, but I mean, most time we have a public hearing.
There've been a few times since I've been on the board that a commissioner will request it be put off.
The public hearing.
The postponement, yeah.
The public hearing, but normally if we had a public hearing, we close it and then just have a vote, play the postponed vote. We have, I don't think we've ever requested to have another public hearing after closing every time.
It's rare.
Right.
It happens once a year.
Typically, you go ahead with the public hearing.
Yeah, then close it, then come out for a vote. Look, we asked for another public hearing, and Commissioner Tam said we'd be liable for it, and I agree with that.
Yeah, I don't think we're okay.
Again, this is just, oh, forgive me, go ahead.
If we make a change that commits us to always changing the sign, always running a new legal ad, and we don't
hold real tight to that, we're not going to postpone public hearings, it's going to be a burden on my staff, and we're just going to be, it's going to be a longer turnaround for this kind of code work that we're up here a lot. We're already pressed pretty tight with the now and the zonings that are coming through. So I'm not telling you can't do it, but if we make that change and continue to postpone a lot of public hearings, there's a lot of legwork associated with that.
Which is why, from a discipline standpoint, the better rule is going to be hearing Mr. Brown. We have it. That's right.
So what do you want to change that, Counselor?
I would request your leave that we bring back a modification that takes away that discretion and makes those things mandatory, and I will draft that.
Can I bring up one other thing? You know, on the 10 copies of this stuff, it actually came up at least once before. How important is this 10 copies thing? In other words, if somebody submitted 9 copies of something that's 10, 20 acres or less, is that really a huge problem for you, Tom? I just hate to trip somebody up because they're one copy shy or something like that.
Well, they know
almost
the rules.
Always we could
take their shoes off.
You know, short of being, we wouldn't do it because it gives someone the opportunity to say we didn't follow the UDC. From just the workings of the office, we could almost always work with 9. And especially today where more and more stuff is digital and we can share things electronically and not have to worry about passing out hard copies.
Well,
I could see that section saying, if there's a concern there, to say, in duplicate as determined by the director or per department policy.
Ken, how do you feel about that? I feel pretty good about that. Everybody else is amenable to it.
Problem is, and you can get more people.
Then you get somebody. Yeah, now everybody will turn in exactly one copy because it says
and argue.
And then say to you,
"That's right.
You got to accept this."
Yeah, and argue
through email now, aren't you, Tom? I mean, digital.
Well, a lot of the communication comes digital, and some of the last minute revisions come digital. But we usually start off on paper still.
Well, does anybody complain about 10 copies? Most of them show up with 10.
We've had it for so long that.
And let's leave it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm
sorry, brother.
So, Council, what kind of motion
do you want? Just a motion to authorize the county attorney and the director of planning and community development to proceed with the UD changes as discussed.
So moved.
Second.
Have a motion and second. Any other discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0.